as well as online and through live stream. We are all together as the body of Christ, worshiping together. Today is the fourth Sunday after Pentecost. Please join me in the confession and forgiveness, which you find on page 3 in your worship folder. Please stand or remain seated. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, whose steadfast love endures forever. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not followed your path. We have chosen our own way. Instead of putting others before ourselves, we long to take the best seats at the table. When met by those in need, we have too often passed by and left us aside. Set us again on the path of life. Save us from ourselves and free us. Hear the good news. God does not deal with us according to our sins, but delights in granting pardon and mercy. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. You are free to love as God loves. Amen. Let us sing the gathering song, hymn number 887, This Is My Song. continue on page 3 in the bosom of Holy Liturgy. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
Rejoice in Jerusalem and be glad for her, all you who love her. Rejoice with her in joy, all you who mourn over her, that you may be nursed and be satisfied from her consoling breast, that you may drink deeply with delight from her glorious bosom. For thus says the Lord, I will extend prosperity to her by her river, and the wealth of the nations like an overflowing stream, and you shall nurse and shall flourish like grass, and it shall be known that the hand of the Lord is with his servants, and his indignation is against his enemies. The word of the Lord. The second reading is from the sixth chapter of Galatians. My friends, if anyone is detected in transgression, you who have received the Spirit should restore such a one in a spirit of gentleness. Take care that you yourselves are not tempted. Bear one another's burdens, and in this way you will fulfill the law of Christ. For those who are nothing think they are something, they deceive themselves. All must test their own work, then that work, rather than their neighbor's work, will become a cause for pride. For all must carry their own loads. Those who are taught the word must share in all good things with their teacher. Do not be deceived. God is not mocked, for you reap whatever you sow. If you sow to your own flesh, you will reap corruption from the flesh. But if you sow to the Spirit, you will reap eternal life from the Spirit. So let us not grow weary in doing what is right, for we will reap at harvest time if we do not give up. So then, whenever we have an opportunity, let us work for the good of all, and especially for those of the family of faith. See what large letters I make when I am away and when I am. It is those who want to make a good showing in the flesh that try to compel you to be circumcised, only that they may not be persecuted for the cross of Christ. Even the circumcised do not want themselves to obey the law, but they want you to be circumcised so that they may boast about your flesh. May I never boast of anything except the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, by which the world has been crucified to me and I to the world. For neither circumcision nor uncircumcision is anything, but a new creation is everything. As to those who will follow this rule, peace be upon them and mercy and upon the Israel of God. The word of the Lord.
He said to them, the harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, ask the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest. Go on your way. See, I am sending you out like lambs into the midst of wolves. Carry no purse, no bag, no sandals, and greet no one on the road. Whatever house you enter, first say, peace to this house. And if anyone is there who shares in peace, your peace will rest on that person. But if not, it will return to you. Remain in the same house, eating and drinking whatever they provide, for the laborer deserves to be paid. Do not move about from house to house. Whenever you enter a town, and its people welcome you, eat what is set before you. Cure the sick who are there, and say to them, the kingdom of God has come near. But whenever you enter a town, and they do not welcome you, go out into its street and say, even the dust of your town that clings to our feet, we wipe off in protest against you. Yet know this, the kingdom of God has come near. Whoever listens to you listens to me, and whoever rejects you rejects me, and whoever rejects me rejects the one who sent me. The 70 returned with joy, saying, Lord, in your name even the demons submit to us. He said to them, I watched Satan fall from heaven like a flash of lightning. See, I have given you authority to tread on snakes and scorpions, and over all the power of the enemy, and nothing will hurt you. Nevertheless, do not rejoice at this, that the spirits submit to you, but rejoice that your names are written in heaven. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Please be seated. See, I am sending you out like lambs into the midst of wolves. That's sort of what like that 4th of July brought to us. Jesus told his 70 of his disciples, saying, I'm sending you out like lambs into the midst of wolves. And that's sort of what it felt like on that 4th of July when Samuel and Denise invited us over to their house for a cookout. We didn't really want to go to Sandra and Denise's house for a couple of reasons. One, we really, just Natalie and I, our little 2-year-old, not quite 3-year-old son Marcus, very active Marcus, we really just would have preferred a nice quiet day at home by ourselves. We also didn't want to go, or I didn't want to go, because there was a World Cup. The United States was playing Brazil. The first time the United States has gotten that far in the World Cup in over 60 years. And it was in Los Angeles. It was a big deal. And I didn't know yet how to record something on TV. I really wanted to watch that soccer game. But mostly why we were reluctant to go is because we didn't know Simon and Denise. They were nearly strangers to us. And it's always a little scary when you go to eat a meal at a stranger's house. But we knew that Jesus said, whenever you enter a town and its people welcome you, eat and drink whatever they put before you. Well, Jesus said, so we had to go. So this is all happening in Youngstown, where the first church I served was pastor. And some of you have heard about me talk about that church. For years it has been going through a racial transition, and the way that the church had engaged the new neighbors coming into their area was that they put up a razor wire on the fence around the parking lot. So in other words, they had no relationship with their new neighbors. Well, we started an after-school program for the kids in the neighborhood to come and to learn about God, to sing, to play games. We called it God's Game of Glory. We weren't sure what the reaction of the neighborhood would have been, but there were a few great families who brought their kids to our after-school program. Among them was Sandra and Denise. Sandra had two boys, Terrence and Tyler. Sandra had a daughter. Denise had a daughter named Sandra. And we didn't know them very well. We barely knew the parents of these kids. They invited us to come to their house for the 4th of July. Well, they had the courage to do this, and it was courage, I have to tell you, because when we finally went, so we said, if they have the courage to invite us strangers, we should have the courage to go to their house and accept their invitation. Well, it was awkward at first. We went to their house, and in their backyard, they set out this huge array of foods, hot dogs, hamburgers, ribs, chicken, and every kind of side dish you can think think of and deserves. And you know, he was just honestly invited to put out his friend. But the conversation was a little bit stilted. It was a little uncomfortable. We were strangers in their house. Until something happened that kind of broke things open. Simon heard Natalie and I talking to our little 2-year-old, not quite 3-year-old Marcus, and heard that we were talking to him, and she said, "Why are you talking to him like that? He ain't got no PhD." See, we were talking to him, to our little Marcus. We didn't use like baby talk or toddler talk. We used adult vocabulary. And that's what we understood in parenting. That's the way to teach language and build vocabulary is to not talk, but in little kid talk. So that guy's talking about different kinds of parenting philosophies. And we started sharing our lives. And it became very obvious the differences between us. The privileges that we had had in our lives that they had not had. Educational opportunities, job opportunities. They actually didn't see much hope for themselves in their lives. They put all their hopes on the lives of their children. That they maybe would have a chance. It was unlike any other 4th of July I've ever had, unlike any other experience with other people I've had. As we made ourselves vulnerable, we strangers, we became maybe neighbors. I did eventually get into the house where there was a fan blowing up a really hot day. I got to watch a little bit of all of that World Cup soccer match, but not much of it, because we were busy. We were busy neighboring. That's new to me, that way of using the word neighbor. Neighbor as a verb. Have you ever heard that before? You ever use neighbor as a verb? It's a book that we're reading. There's a book we're reading, the collaborative team, your collaborative team, David and a few others of us. We're reading a book right now together called The Art of Neighboring. It's written by a couple of pastors, and their assertion is that what church needs today, what we need to do is we can't just, with no longer works, just open your doors and have events and hope that people come. No, that what we need to do is to be out. The calling of the Christian, church member is to be out, loving our neighbors. But how do you love your neighbors if you don't know your neighbors? There's an interesting exercise we have here where there are a series of boxes. You put yourself and your house in the middle box, and then you put the houses behind you, the houses in front of you, the houses to the side, so that you have 8 boxes of the houses surrounding you. And that doesn't work for everyone, because some of us, like us, we live on the end. We have a parking lot across the street. But you choose the 8 neighbors you have closest to you, the 8 homes. And you try to fill out 3 different categories. You first list in each box the names of those people. Great if you know first and last names, but write, list their names. And then list something about them, some relevant information that you can only know by talking to them, not like, oh, this, he drives a red Corvette, but rather where they're from, what their hobbies are, something about themselves that you couldn't see by standing in front of them. And then the third thing you write down is some in-depth information that you would know only by connecting with people. about your family history, your dreams, what you see as your purpose in life. What do you most fear? And write those things down. Here's the thing they found. After doing this with many, many churches, what they found is that only about 10% of people can fill out the names of all 8 of their neighbors around them. 10%. About 3% can name some kind of detail about them that they couldn't tell just by standing in the driveway. And less than 1% could say something in depth about the people and their lives who we live with. Neighbor is a verb. The art of neighboring. It's something that takes courage. Something that can be really awkward and uncomfortable. But if we're called to love our neighbor, how can we love our neighbor if we don't know our neighbors? Now, I was thinking about this past week, over the last week or two. There have been some things going on in our country. There's always things going on in our country. It seems like a lot of troubling things happening in our country are happening all the time. This past week or so, the Supreme Court has handed down some decisions, several decisions, that are going to impact the lives of many Americans. Some people celebrate this. Some people grieve these decisions. Some people are very happy and pleased. Some are angry and worried about the future. There are complex issues. All these things the Supreme Court has set down decisions about, but they are going to change people's lives. And all the arguments I've read, the opinions back and forth, one thing I've noticed is that there is very little that seems to be said about loving our neighbors. Of what it means to know our neighbors, to, as Jesus says, love God and love your neighbor, to love our neighbors ourselves, to have opinions that are not just about what's good for me or about what is good for my neighbor. What my neighbor's needs are. My neighbor's lives and concerns. And I'm thinking, what would it mean to truly live a neighbor-centered life? And take that very seriously. Because I think that that's one of the ways that we have a lot of things to be proud of about our country. I think it's one of the things that it's a growth area for us still. Because I think that while we celebrate independence, which is all good, independence, freedom, every country has these days. Celebrate their country, celebrate their independence, and we do it well. But independence is not always exactly what the life that Jesus calls us to. Because as he talks about loving your neighbor, putting your neighbor's life at the center of ours. What he's talking about is not independence, but interdependence. Interdependence. We depend on each other. And how can we depend on each other if we don't know each other? How can we love our neighbor if our neighbor is not at the center of our lives? But always remember that 4th of July at Sandra Lindy's house, where we made ourselves vulnerable, where we had courage. Well, I didn't tell you this part, the courage that we had to go to a stranger's house. Denise finally admitted to me that She was scared when she first saw me wear my clerical top. She said, that was scary. But it would have been worse if I was wearing a suit and tie, she said. Because a white man wearing a suit and tie in her neighborhood, no good could ever come of that. Courage. Opening ourselves up. This is the call Jesus has for us. This is what it means to love our neighbor. It was unclear with Andrew and Eve who was the wolf and who was the lamb. But that's how life is, right? Who's the wolf and who's the lamb? Well, when we're neighbors, true neighbors, as Jesus says, the kingdom of God has come near. My friends, the kingdom of God has come near to us. To that the church said, amen. Together sing our hymn of the day. It's hymn number 546, To Be Your Presence. Please stand as you thank you.
Send your church into the world, bringing Christ and creation to all. Renew the church as it carries out your mission of peace and healing. We pray for missionaries who accompany your people. Lord, in your mercy. Your creation abounds with flowing waters and diverse creatures. Guide the work of climate scientists as they develop and advocate ways to restore Earth's natural balance. Motivate humankind to adopt lifestyles that protect and sustain the Earth. Lord, in your mercy. Regard the nations. Let no leader exalt themselves, but lift up the most vulnerable and work for the good of all. Send your spirit to eradicate classism and inequity, violence and war, poverty and hunger. Lord, in your mercy. You desire abundant life for all. As we celebrate Independence Day, instill in us gratitude, generosity, and persistence in working towards freedom for all people. Lord, in your mercy. Loving God, we care for all people in need. Nourish those who are hungry. Restore employment to those who have lost work. Heal those who are sick. Comfort all who are dying or grieving. Especially Gloria, Phyllis, Judith, Joyce, Lynn, Pat, Simon and Sarah, Jackson, Grant, Candy and Jerry, Jean, Rachel, Lori, Dave, Sheila, Lauren, Sandy and Joe, Larry, Andy, David, Sue and Ted, Tim, Lisa, Matthew, Peggy, Patricia, Elam, Mark, Jean and Bob, Kathy, Dalmore and Carolyn, Lauren, Sean, Ruth, Jack, Virginia, Jane, Emma, Mary, and Uncle Mike. Lord, in your mercy. We remember the saints who proclaimed your reign on earth and now rest in you. Make us faithful in our witness to Christ's new creation. Lord, in your mercy. God of every time and place, in Jesus' name, fill with your Holy Spirit, may trust these spoken prayers and those in our hearts into your holy faith. Amen.
The peace of Christ be with you always. Let us share a sign of peace with one another. Thank you. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup. He gave thanks and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for remembrance of me." Let us pray together as Jesus taught. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. You are all invited to Jesus' inclusive banquet of love. Please be seated.
Thank you.
Please rise. We give you thanks, generous God, for this bread of God we have tasted the new heaven and earth, where hunger and thirst are no more. Send us from this table as witnesses to the resurrection, that through our lives all may know life.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine on you with grace and mercy. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen. Let's together sing our sending song, hymn number 888, O beautiful and spacious skies.
Moved by the Holy Spirit, go in peace, serve the Lord.